how many of you think your coach is killing your agility? Is there anybody thinking like that? Please, please raise your hands.
We blame the process, not the person.
So, seems like a very interesting discussion. Let's welcome our next keynote speaker, Mr. Madhul Kazaria, a CSC and CSCFL. Madhul will take this discussion forward.
Okay, good morning.
Good morning.
So, I think Ali kind of scared you already. So, I thought I will not try to scare you and bring on some more elements. Some of you are already aware, so my name is Madhur and I am a certified Scrum trainer, certified enterprise coach. And I have been trying to do something in the field of Scrum for some time now, maybe over a decade. So let's talk about why I chose this topic, by the way. So let's start with a little poll. How many of you are working as an agile coach here? Okay. How many have been working with agile coaches? Okay. Now, as probably you're aware, Agile coach is probably the third fastest growing profession in India, right? And that's a data which has come from Naukri.com. So I'm not saying this is what Naukri.com is saying. But why do you think this is so lucrative? Why everybody wants to become an Agile coach? So that's something that I want to talk about today. And what's the anatomy of an Agile coach? And if the coaching is not right, what damage it can create? So that is something that I talked about. And as coaches, as managers who are working with coaches, what do we need to drive? So that is something that we need to, that I'll try to bring in from this discussion today. And before I proceed, I said thanks to Dr. Agile to ask me to be here. So, you know who is Dr. Agile here, right? Or very well, Mr. Saket. So he's on Dr. Agile, I always call him Dr. Agile. And I'll tell you shortly why, but that's a separate discussion. By the way, let's start this discussion with a little story. Good? And I'm sure a lot of you can relate to this story. So once upon a time, everything was going happy, everything was going well, everything was going fine. And we had a lot of projects, we had a lot of project managers going on, and they used to manage the projects very well. When did this happen? Remember last time? Everything was going fine, we had a lot of project management. PMP was the mainstay, even it is still the mainstay. So when was that? Anybody remembers? Not so long ago, right? Okay. But then something happened. What happened? Projects started failing, right? They were not exactly as per the expectations from the customers. They were not as per the expectations from the management itself. Did that happen with some of you? Yes or no? As clearly mentioned, it has to be more participative. If you are not participating, then I have to call Baba Ramdev. And I know some of you have been waiting for Baba Ramdev to be here, so he's going to be here soon. Now, obviously, customers were not very happy. So that's when another monster was also seen in the world. And that was probably 5 to 7 years back. And in the Indian industry, probably, yes, exactly in 2010. And which monster I'm talking about? Yes. So this is the monster I'm talking about. And did it change our lives? That's the precise reason we are all here, right? Yes or no?
Yes.
Right? So what changed here? So some of us who are managers, and some managers, they had choices. So the first manager, what he thought was, this is not happening. When I'm a manager and Agile is coming, I have no role to play. Did that happen? Yes. Now I need to do something else. Okay, so we're also going to come to that. Now why I'm talking about managers shortly? We have the second breed of managers who are, I don't believe in agility. Right? This is not something for us. This is going to kill us. So let's try to move away. In fact, TV mentioned something about this when we were talking about that. It is more focused on command and control. This is still, we fight agility, we talk about resources, we talk about everything is a resource, move resource from here to there. We talked about this a little earlier, right? So we had those kind of managers. And then we had the third ones, right? They discovered a trend, and this trend's name was Agile. And they took advantage of it, they took benefits from it, they helped their teams, and now they were ready to do something bigger. So what did they do? So how many of you actually did that transformation? Let me ask you a little question here. Oh, I was a manager earlier and now I am a coach. Yes, I see one hand going up, one courageous hand going up. Is your role? We are trying to do it. Okay. Now, this role of coach, where did it originate from?
Sports.
Okay. And when you see coaches in sports, what does that mean? What do they do for the team? They guide the team. And how do they guide the team? They study the
individuals.
Okay. And they monitor how the team is performing. And they mentor them. Okay. On the ground. Good. Do they tell them on the ground how exactly what to do? So what do they do? Whatever coaching, whatever discussions they have to have, where they have to find out, where to have to do that? Where do they do it?
Before the game.
But during the game?
They
are observers. They do not decide what the team will do. It's the team decides how they are going to play, who is going to play a role, how are they going to run over. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Now let's try to apply this metaphor and do something, a little activity. All of your notepads and pens on your tables. Let's do a little activity to identify what overcoaches do. I'm sure some of you have been working as a coach, some of you have been working with coaches. So can you write down in your current environment, if you're working with a coach or a scrum master, what are the activities that they are doing? So why don't we write this down with you? You're not just here to listen, you have to write and you have to do some activities also. That's my promise. So go ahead. Responsibilities you have written, and just before writing this, you answered question about what are the sports coaches like. So what additional thing your coaches are doing right now? If you could let me know. Apart from what the sports coaches have been doing, what additional your coaches are doing? Yes, go ahead please.
They also participate in pieces.
They also participate in pieces, okay, and that would be like?
When they, like some of us, we need to go out to find patients, and
okay, good. Any more?
They transform the organization.
They transform the organization. Okay, good.
They're collecting
the data. Okay.
Trying to implement the data, giving their perspective on the respective domains, maybe a data warehouse or SAP or something.
Implementing best practices, giving the perspectives, and so on and so forth. Okay, more things?
Try to be part of the technologies for people.
Okay, good.
They're implementing a mailer in a new format called a cartoon style. So that it's something easy to transform.
Good. And unfortunately, why in fact I brought about this topic, when you hear the word coach, that's exactly what the coaches are not supposed to do. Because when the word coach comes, it has a very specific meaning. What's the difference between a coach and a consultant? Some of your consultants here. What's the difference? Coaches are going to give their
Yes, so
I think Evan mentioned it very, very clearly, and that's the right word that I was looking for. Coaches are not solution providers. Coaches do not provide solutions. They do not provide practices or perspectives. A coach's role has always been to ask questions, to show a mirror and then let the team correct.
Right?
And that's why when you transition from a manager to coach's role, you go through these various notions. You are a manager, sometimes you are a technical mentor, sometimes you are a hands-on expert. So you go from a delivery manager through this whole channel. But if you see the coach's role, it is right on the top. Is that correct? So what does it do? I will assist you in performing your best. I will bring out the best in you. So that's what the coach's promise is. It is not a promise your delivery will be better. It is not a promise your process will be better. It is not a promise we will do something else. His promise is to assist you to be better. Now that word is very important, assist. He is not guiding, mentoring, telling you, or this is what you have to do. Good? And that's why when we talk about a coach's role, there are different perspectives that we need to bring in. Good? And now we do our next activity from this perspective. Because a lot of us have different perceptions about a coach's role. So I want to do a little activity. It is called as the mirror exercise. I am going to give you four questions on the slide, which are on the next slide. And as a table, you are supposed to answer those four questions from a coach's perspective. Good? Okay. Yes. So I'm going to ask each team to put on two hats. Or three hats. The first hat is the coaches themselves. If I am a coach, you have to answer these questions. Second, from an executive management, from a senior management perspective, what should a coach do? And third, from a team perspective in your organization, what do they expect the coach to do? Clear? So discuss as a team together and then come up with these three perspectives. 5 minutes for this, so go ahead quickly. Discuss as a team together. We can continue, but next 2 days also we'll not be able to finish this. But when you put on those three different hats, did you see a difference in perception?
Yes.
And that's where the first conflict starts for a coach. Right? Do I follow what the management says? Do I follow what my gut feel or what my profession says? Or do I just satisfy the team? Whom do I follow? So when I picked up this topic, that was one of my main reasons to pick up this topic. As coaches, are the coaches that are working with us, are we really doing justice to the profession? Or are we just becoming a process instigator, somebody who tells, okay, this is the process you are supposed to do. A coach is way beyond the process. So now what I want to do is I'll go a little deeper into the role of the coach and what does it really mean. And then we're going to do a couple of more activities. So this is the dilemma of the transformation for many organizations, right? Do we use Scrum? Do we use Safe? Do we use Less? Do we use anything else? Does the dilemma always come? Okay. Now, how fast do we do it? Do we do it slow? Do we do it fast? That is always a dilemma. Does that happen? Do we focus more on delivery and projects, or do we focus on improving our processes? Is that also a dilemma? Yes. And then what do they do next? Because we do not know what to do now, what do they do next? Let's hire a coach, right? He has a silver bullet which will solve every one of the processes. Because I think he was mentioned on the culture part, right? Or he will do a transformation van and everything is fine. Does that really happen so easily?
No.
No, obviously not. So this is the mirror exercise that we just now did, so I'll go forward. And this is where the problem is. The mismatch of expectations. Isn't that what we just now discovered? How do we solve this problem? The first part is to understand the buyer.
Can we go back to the previous?
Yes. Yeah, you'll get all these slide sets. You don't need to really cram or write all these down. But what I wanted to bring about from the slide is, this is the difference in the opinion that the coaches will always have to face, right? And that's the dilemma that they're in fact. My very first blog, when I wrote in 2011, was about from a coach's perspective. The blog was called Shark. Have you heard about shark attacks?
Yeah.
Right? So the coaches, they always face shark attacks during their assignments. Have you also faced a shark attack?
Yeah, I have observed.
Yes, so what happens there?
Everybody thinks that you are going to be a savior.
Yes.
The whole hit is on you.
Yes, and we are fine. Don't trouble us. Talk to the other team. Management says we are fine. It's the team which needs discipline. Team says we are fine. Management is the problem. And what does the coach do? Torn in the middle? Right? So it is very important that as a coach you understand the buyer. Right? What the first prospective sponsor, the prospective champion and so on, what do they really want? That is something that is going to be the first key. Now, from a buyer perspective, is management the only customer? No. So who are the other customers for a coach?
Team.
The team, right? And this is where the fine balance the coach has to create between what the team expects and what the sponsor or the business or the customer expects. So this is where the fine dilemma comes into picture. Right? So just to answer these two questions, what is the current work culture that they are working on? Because for example, TV talked about the enroll culture, and is the culture very toxic, the culture very supportive, and give you an example of Mastek also. So finding out that culture, what is it important? It is not just about a process audit, oh we are doing Scrum, we are doing Safe, we are doing something else. Because as a coach, you are going to be working with people, you have to first think about the culture. The second part is, who are the ones who are really in need of coaching? Are we coaching the people who already sold or who already know what they are supposed to do because the management says so or somebody says so? Or are we really trying to find out who are the people whom we really need to work with? Good. Then, why do they need it and how much do they need? So before we start that coaching role, whether you are internal, external, in any role, these are the few questions that you need to get answered, to get prepared. Good? Then, sometimes what you are told, as I have always said, right? I have always said this in my classes also. We live in the age of information icebergs. Yes, please.
Do you think like a self-managed, empowered team, they don't need a coach?
I would say, to some extent, everybody needs a coach. Do you know why? Okay. Let's talk about a couple. Good? And I always give this example in a CSM class, some of you know about it. So a couple, when they get started, what is the first few days or weeks called? Honeymoon period, right? Everything is going fine and everything is smooth and they respect each other and those kind of things. And then the entertainment phase starts. For the neighbors, obviously, right? What's happening in that entertainment phase? What kind of sentences do you hear? You did not, you did learn anything from your parents' house. You don't care about me. You know, the towel on the floor. Have you heard about all those kind of things? Okay. Yes. Then comes the third phase. After a while of this entertainment phase, then comes the third phase, which is nirvana. Ab kuch nahi ho sakta. Now nothing can be done. Right? Now we are stuck. And then they come to the final stage. Now let's think about a bigger family and so on. So every couple goes through the same phase. Same way, every team goes through similar phases. Now there is a very famous model from PM Bob which is applied to this. What am I talking about here? The Tuckman's model. Forming, storming, norming and performing. Right? But in that storming stage for a couple, are they always not looking for a mentor or a guide or somebody to shoulder to cry on, somebody who can look after them, somebody who can guide you to the right path? Yes. Right? If your team is very stable, if they really understand each other, yes, they don't require anyone after a while. But if your team is changing, right, they will still need someone whom they can talk to and probably find the right path. So yes, whether this coach is internal, external, being a manager or somebody else coaching each other, even that is, so we are not stating that, oh, he has to be an external coach, right? It may be your team member who is your best buddy who is also your coach. Lot of times, if you have seen, as couples, and a lot of us are married here, don't we coach each other, you know, day-to-day lives? Or you should not have done the right way, are you doing it right from your career perspective? Don't we do the coaching every day? Yes. So everyone requires some coaching every day. You can't escape it. Good?
But,
pardon?
Difference between coaching and counseling.
Good one. Right? Now if you go here, I go back a couple of slides here. You see that? Right? Counselor, where will he or she sit in? A counselor is just trying to listen to you, right? And then based on this experience of providing solution, maybe you should do this, maybe try this, maybe try this. That's what the counselors do, right? Typically, the doctors, that's what they do. But what is the coach doing? He is asking and pushing you to find the right path, not giving the path himself, right? Or herself. That's the key difference we are talking about. Clear?
Okay.
So let's go forward because I have lesser time, so I'm trying to push forward. The slides you're going to be getting, so you don't need to kind of write everything down and so on. And that's why I said, if I come back to the slide that I was talking about, we live in an age of information iceberg, is that correct? Okay. You see the breaking news today, right? In fact, I was watching just news outside. The breaking news was some party is doing a protest because we are being targeted. Right? Now, what's the real story behind it? Do we ever come to know? Because we only get to know what is sold to us on the TV channels, is that correct? Same way, if you remember, TV was same way also asking about that this information that we have about the products, the strategy and so on, where all it gets restricted? In the boardrooms, is that correct? Nothing comes out of that. And that's where when we talk about a coach will be able to see beyond the obvious. See, go beyond what is on the surface and try to find out. If someone is angry, have you been into a situation where someone was angry with you? We go through sometimes all the time, right? But why does somebody become angry? Pardon? Not meeting the expectations, okay. Any other reasons?
Disappointment,
okay. Okay. We may have hurt him or her, okay, good.
Want to escape from the situation.
They want to escape from the situation. Don't trouble me and target me. If I get targeted, yeah. I will also target you. Does that happen? So anger is just one emotion, but what are the real reasons behind it, for example? Now sometimes I've seen, I want to change my job, I'm feeling frustrated. Has that happened to you? But does that frustration build up in a day?
No.
It is always a series of activities, series of transactions, series of events which has happened, which is building up this transaction. right? So as a coach, you need to be able to understand what is beyond the obvious. If the organization is going through a big transition, a lot of people are leaving, is the real reason because of the transition or something else is happening behind? And that's why the coach also needs to act as an investigator, right? Looking beyond the obvious, trying to find out the real reason. And what kind of skills will the coach will need to have if they want to be the investigator? Do they need to ask the right questions?
Yeah.
Do they need to ask? Do they need to ask these questions to the right people? Yes or no?
Yes.
Do they need to ask these questions at the right time?
Yes.
Correct? So being able to identify what is the right time, right people and the right questions to ask is a very powerful tool for the coaches. Now, obviously, and be able to identify those stories and from those stories what you can do. So that is something which is very, very important from a coach's perspective. Good? Now let me quickly, this is something I don't want to talk about because this is what we know already. Isn't that the case? Okay. Now why this is important? A lot of teams have seen and why I thought about this point, particularly in our context here. Why it is important for a coach to be transparent?
Trust. People won't come to him.
Pardon?
He is not transparent.
Yes.
Or if he is not able to share the information to the right audience, to the right, at the right time, people will not like to be...
So the trust factor comes into picture, is that correct? So the currency on which a coach operates is not authority. Coach has no authority on the team, is that correct?
Yes.
So the currency that the coach will operate on always is the trust. So what are you doing as a coach to build trust? Now is the trust built only with the management? With the team also, with the customers also, with your delivery manager also, with your infrastructure guy also. So building trust across is something which is very, very important from a coach's perspective. Good? Okay. Now I'm going to push a little further and talk about the different roles that the coach has to do. This is summarizing the discussion that we just now had. Sometimes the coach is a teacher, teaching about specific techniques, skill sets, scrum, safe, and those kind of things. Does that happen? Sometimes he is a life coach. Why the life coach? Why is that required? Because we are not transforming just the processes, we are transforming people and organizations. That is the DNA of it, right? So they need somebody to talk to. For example, somebody who is very introvert in a scrum team, you see they are not talking and they are feeling frustrated, but they don't talk to anyone. Sometimes the coach has to sit down with the person and be able to talk to them. So that's where the life coaching also comes into picture. Change facilitator, right? Bringing about disruption into the environment, bringing about, a lot of times why I always said that a coach should be external, and it's not just because of my bread and butter. Why I always said so? Because sometimes as coaches we get ingrained in the system. This is how it happens here, right? SI chalta hai, this is how it works here. If you're not disrupting the system, you will not be able to bring about those lasting changes that we're talking about. Coaching is not just about, now we are using Scrum and I'll teach you Scrum. Or I'll teach you safe, or I'll teach you less. Coaches is much more beyond that. Good? So a coach has to play multiple roles depending on the time, depending on the people that you are talking about. Second, are you coaching the teams or are you coaching the roles? Now a lot of times I've seen, oh, I'm a team coach. In fact, Scrum has a knockout designation like enterprise coach, team coach, leadership coach. Right? So whom are we really teaching? Whom are we really coaching? Are we coaching a particular team together or are we coaching different roles within the team? Good? Pardon?
Combination of both.
A combination of both. Now, why can't you coach a team?
Because you cannot just correct one part and other part to be the same.
Okay.
All the parts together so that the flavor of that particular correction can be seen.
Okay. Now, the team, who are, which people is it made up of? Are they all similar people with similar behaviors, similar backgrounds? No. So every person in that team has a unique personality. Do we all agree?
Yes.
Yes. So that means they will have their own dilemma, they'll have their assumption, they'll have their behavior traits and so on. So whether we say we are teaching an enterprise, they are coaching a team and so on, ultimately what it boils down to is you are coaching the respective roles. Good? And that's there, now I want to do our next activity. So why don't we identify in our organization, as you are going towards agility, as you are walking towards agility, what are the three key roles that you think are most difficult to convince about agility and this is how you should do, right? Or where you are facing challenge in your transformation. So like, why don't we write down these three roles quickly? So write down these three roles, which where you think you are facing the most challenge in terms of convincing them, in terms of their behaviors, in terms of how they work with the team, and so on and so forth. Value would a delivery manager be looking for? Meeting timelines, on-time deliveries, and so on. And how does it create value for them if you're meeting timelines and on-time deliveries?
Customer satisfaction.
And customers are satisfied, what happens?
More business.
If there's more business, what happens? Pardon?
More money.
If there's more money, what happens? Pardon?
More bonus.
Salary hike.
More bonus ticket.
Now, why I'm asking all these questions? Because if you remember, there's a talk about beyond thinking, beyond obvious. My obvious thought is, this guy is looking for better delivery. But everybody in the world is selfish. They don't care about organization or what you are doing. What do they care about? Whatever is happening, how is it helping?
Me.
Right? So are you creating a real value for them? It's not just about I'm creating value for the organization, delivery, and so on and so forth. As a coach, what value are you creating for the person you are talking to? Why should they listen to you? You are an external entity, you have been posted in by the management, so why should they listen to you? The trust starts when you create value for the person that you are talking to or you are coaching. In a sports arena also, why should the players listen to the coach? Why do they listen? Because the coach helps them, their performance is better. They play a bigger role in the team. That means their stature rises. So that's why they listen to the coach. Not because he is a coach, he has to be listened. He is not a prophet or a lord or a god or anybody else. Is that correct? So that is something that we need to focus upon. Think beyond the obvious and find out what is going on beyond the team level. How I can help them. Good. So team profiling, understanding the processes, understanding the dynamics, stakeholders in the environment. These are few important aspects. When you start your assignment as an agile coach, you have to focus on that. Good? Clear? Okay. So these key steps that you see here, telling, selling, consulting, and participating. These are the notions which every coach will go through their assignment lifetime. First, they are the storytellers. Okay. Oh, I'll tell you the story of my past organization. I'll tell you the case study that I did. I'll tell you what I did with my last customer. Have you heard those stories from your coaches?
Yes.
This is what happened there. But why? Personally, I hate those case studies. Why do I say so? Why do I hate case studies?
That is your mindset.
Pardon?
That is your mindset.
That will be your mindset, okay? It creates a barrier to your thinking because that case study was valid for a customer in their context, right? In your context, will it be really valid?
No,
right? May not be. So the moment you are thinking about a case study or somebody said, so in fact, a lot of people have written, in fact, I find some very funny books. I find books on the bookshelves when I go to the airport, how to become a millionaire. Have you seen those books?
Yes.
Right? And the author of that book, and the, it very proudly says, he is still very down to earth and he doesn't own many things and he lives in a simple house and so on. If you can tell other people how to become a millionaire, why didn't you become yourself? Right? So same is the part about a coach. Right? A coaching does not start by telling stories. Yes, you bring out those stories, but a coaching starts with participation. We are together. I am there to work with you to discover your best. So that is where the coach has to go. Not just by telling and selling. This is where the key responsibility of coach lies, to move beyond the obvious, think out of the box, bring out the solutions which really work for them. Good? And that's why understanding the coaching profile also, the person you are talking to, the person you are mentoring is very, very important. Good? Is he looking for a mentor? Right? Is he looking for a collaborator? Is he looking for an enthusiast? Or is he looking for an instructor? Most of us think the coach's role is here. Right? Give me the information. Teach me about Scrum. No. But the real value comes here. You see this? Asking the right questions, helping them build the right platform, right org structure, and so on and so forth. But does this transition happen in 3 months? No. 2 months? Because a lot of times from my customers, I always get, we need a coach for 2 days a week for next 3 months. Have you also been to be into that situation? And what exactly this guy is going to do then? 2 days for 3 months? 2 days a week for 3 months? Stamp, oh, this form is formally coached. Does it really help anyone? When we always say the sports coaching also, what do they always say? Because the World Cup is in 2020, we'll assign a coach in 2016 so that this guy can build a relationship with the team. So the coaches and the coaches have a relationship that they need to build. That does not happen in 2 days a week or 1 day a week. Or they have to be continuously involved. Good? So this is where the change of behavior and change of habit comes. And to move from this part to this is a long journey. It does not happen overnight. It does not happen 2 days or 1 day or 3 days. It has to be a continuous engagement if you really want to bring that lasting change. Good? Okay. So now let's do a little activity. Good? Now this is something which is which could be very, very effective if you use it well, or it could be very disruptive also. Good? Now what I want to do is, I want to obviously go back to Baba Ramdev. Baba Ramdev always helps me. I want each one of us to close their eyes. Good? And think about probably your most low moment that you had in your life. I'm not talking about work or anywhere, it could be anywhere. So think about for a minute, close your eyes, go back to your past, and think about the most low moment you were in your life. I don't want to probably discuss, or you may also not to discuss, why it was a low moment and what was the dilemma and so on, right? But for a couple of minutes, discuss with each other, how did you come out of that low moment, right? And how do you feel now after maybe so many years, so many months and so many weeks? Third question says, what you would have done differently? Now you may tell the context, you may not tell the context, that is up to you. But just say it out to them, good? Here, understanding is not important, saying is. So go ahead, tell the person on your right, how did you come out of that low moment, and how do you feel now after so many days, weeks and months? Go ahead.
Thank you.
Okay, 30 seconds. In last 2 minutes. For some it was fear. Can I really tell this to this person? Did that happen? Okay. For some it was a relief. Now I can probably talk to some of the total strangers I've never met and I can really let my heart out. Did that also happen for at least some of us?
No.
No? Did not happen? Okay. For some said yes and some of us said big no. Okay. What were the other emotions which you're going through?
Summarize the entire feeling in few words, and especially to an unknown without background.
Without background, okay.
Especially
say it
in those lines, you know.
Okay.
How
good.
Did it matter to me?
How does it matter to me?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, why did I bring about this? This is exactly where the coaching starts,
yeah.
Right? First, if I am not comfortable telling about what I did. And how I did, how I came on my low points and so on. Why do I expect someone to come and talk to me? You are a total stranger in the room, right? So why should they come and talk to you? What environment are you creating for them to be able to talk to you? Now that's why this whole top-driven change, top-driven agility, top-driven, we will do this, we should use Scrum, we should use this. Why I have always hated this? The reason simply is, I start following another process without really changing this mindset, behavior and the transformation that we really want to bring in. It again becomes superficial process transformation. And if you just now observe, you have taken your first step to coaching.
Yeah.
What was that first step?
Pardon?
Unless you open up to someone, why would they open up to you? Is that correct?
Yes.
Collaboration and communication can never be one way, it always has to be two way. If you don't speak your heart out, why do you expect the other person to speak their heart out? Is that correct? So, as a coach, this is the first thing that we need to understand. Are we just doing a lip service by doing a process part? Or are we really opening the hearts out and the mindset change that we want to bring about? Good? Okay. But this all looks tough, right? Good to say in this session, but it all looks tough. So now, for next last 5 minutes, what I want to do is I want to spend some time in what you can do about it. So first is this A to F of coaching, as I always say. The first A is asking, why do you want to do this transformation? Why are you talking about agility? Why are you talking about changing your teams? So first question that a coach always has to ask is, why? Now, this would be a very tough question to ask when you are asking this to executives. Because why they don't have the agile transformation? Because my competitor is doing so. Because the customer is asking for it. Whether I really believe in it? Maybe not. Right? So asking this question why is very important whenever you see a top-down transformation. We always, and this is where I think I contradict few of the authors which always say your management first has to be convinced and only then your agility will work. Good? A top-down agility is always better. But if they don't understand why, will the team be in more trouble? Are you facing some of those?
Yes.
Exactly. So this is the question that you need to ask. Second part, as I mentioned, I summarize this also. No case study is going to help here. No book is going to help here. Agility was the very first part of the manifesto. Individuals and interactions matter moreover. Process and tools. So it's a team that their materials, their mindset, their opinion is more important. So you have to bake your own dog food. You have to find your own process. You have to find your own pace of transformation. No other expert can help you there. They can help you ask the right question, but it's a team will decide. Second, remember this I talked about value for everyone. Now this is something that I'll come to a little later, why this is important. Rather than having it top down. So let's say you start an agile transformation and there are 500 people in an organization who are starting this. Out of which, if they were given a chance, we don't want to do agility and you can do whatever you want to do. How many would abandon whatever you are doing now in terms of agile? Let's take a quick poll here. If you were given a choice in your organization, whatever agility you are doing, you have a choice to leave it and do what you want to do. I see one hand at least going, one courageous hand. How do you say, no, I don't want to do it? Okay, few hands. Pardon?
Insecurity starts.
The insecurity starts. What I'm saying is, without any consequences, now you are given a choice. You decide what you want to do. You can leave the current methods, current way of working. How many of you would go ahead with that? Pardon?
That's not the idea.
Exactly. So when we talk about the very first manifesto principle is people matter more over process and tools. But in terms of giving the agile transformation, are we giving a choice to our teams that they can choose whether first of all they need agility or agile methods or agile philosophy? Are they allowed to choose which methods, which practices from the agile world they are allowed to implement? Are they allowed to choose their pace of transformation? No. And then, does the buy-in occur from the team? No. And then we are just implementing yet another process. We are violating the very first part of the manifesto. So the power of opt-in is very, very important. Not driven by the leadership or a coach or a top management. Then comes the next part. I think TV touched it very, 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 very beautifully. It is not just about engineering. Do we all agree? Yes, you have the HR, you have the admin, you have the sales, you have the operations. Everyone who is part of or affecting the team, they need to understand what we are doing. Right? What the role the HR has to play here now? The HR function or the talent function?
Career roadmaps.
Pardon?
Career roadmaps.
Well, how does it affect your agility or the agile philosophy that you are adopting? If the HR does not play the role well, will it affect our agility in any way? My appraisal process still remains in focus on individual brilliance, but team now we are saying team.
Team motivation will go down team. In case nobody cares.
Okay. Now, yes, if the operations of the IT does not give the right office space to sit and the right facilities and so on, does it also lead to frustration? Your performance goes down and then there's the pressure, right? So even they need to understand what we are talking about. So agility is not just about one function. It is about the whole end-to-end enterprise transformation we are talking about. So as a coach, it is not just from an engineering perspective that, oh, we are coaching engineering teams. Are you talking to HR? Are you talking to admin? Are you talking to sales guys? Most of the cases I have seen, coaches are not given access to that. Is it correct? So that is something which is very important for us to understand. Now, as a last part, because Pierre is showing me, I would like to introduce you to this particular framework. So if you want to read more about this opt-in power, the power of opt-in, go to openspaceagility.com and read what the author Daniel Magic says here. He has brought it out very beautifully. In fact, he's coming to India doing a workshop in June. So in case you want to read more about the power of opt-in and how it can help your transformation, please read through that. So that's something that I would definitely recommend. Good. So now we have come to the end of session. We have got about a minute to go. So I thought I will introduce something which could be a good mantra for you to succeed as a coach. And for that, we have to always call Baba Ramdev. So when you hear Baba Ramdev, what do you do?
Close
your eyes. No. When you hear Baba Ramdev, what do? You cannot be seated first of all. So first you have to get up from your seats quickly.
Don't lie down, let's run around. It's early morning. Now what I want you to do is, I want you to find a pair partner, not in your row and not on the table that you're sitting around, but somewhere in other parts of the room. Find a pair partner, everyone. Find a pair partner.
What? Together, good. Hi, Anu.
Hi.
Yes, find a pair partner.
Hi. Where do you work?
I am a
somewhere in the room, not on the same row, not on the same table as you.
I work for TV.
Have you done that? If you don't have a pair partner yet, please raise your hand. If you don't have a pair partner, raise your hand and find out. There is one more hand raised here. If you don't have a pair partner, please raise your hand. Everybody has a pair partner? Okay, good. So now we are going to start a little activity which you used to do as kids, and why this is very important you will realize. Okay?
No,
coaching is, hold on, guys, let's come back. Coaching is not just about one person. Do we all agree?
Yes.
We have to involve everyone. Do we also all agree?
Yes.
Right? We have to create value for everyone. Did you also discuss this?
Yes.
So I want to demonstrate this through a little activity. Good? Now we are going to play a little game which my daughter always used to play when she was like 6-7 years old. And that is called a stone, paper, scissor. Anybody remembers this game?
Yes.
Okay. So when we say stone, what symbol do we create? This is the stone, is that correct?
Yes.
So when we say paper, this is the paper. And when we say scissor, so this is the scissor, is that correct?
Yes.
Now, each pair is going to play this game of stone, paper, scissor. Good? So let me just put this here. So what will happen is, each will do 1, 2, 3, and the count of 3, you show the symbol to your partner. Now if it's a paper and a stone, who wins? Because paper can wrap around the stone. If it's a stone and a scissor? Because scissor can be broken by the stone. But what about scissor and the paper?
Scissor.
Clear? But if you are winner from one pair, your job does not end there. What you have to now do is, you have to go to the winner from another pair and then compete with them. Good? And this way we will continue till the time we have a single winner in the team, in this whole room. Are you clear? Okay. Good, good. Hold on. But the people who are losing, the team members who are losing, but it's their room.
No.
Yes, so they are the cheerleaders. So they are going to call their partner by their name and cheer them up. Good. For example, if Evan wins, I'm going to cheer up Evan's name. Evan, right? If Jaya wins, I'll cheer Jaya's name. Jaya. Clear on this?
Okay.
And as the competition gets tougher, will your cheerleaders also increase?
Yes.
So more the number of cheerleaders, more names you have to shout out of your partners. Are we clear?
Yes.
Ready? Get set.
Yeah.
Go on the count of three, we'll start this game. One, two, three.
Okay.
And if you don't get the winner in first round, repeat it. If you don't get the winner in first round, repeat it. Yes, keep cheering for your team members. Keep cheering for team members. Cheer for your team members. Cheer for your winners. Cheer for your winners. Cheer for your winners. Very important. Cheer for your winners. Yes, so we are winners here. You now have to cheer for him. Cheer for him. Find another person. Yes. And then cheer for him. Guys, cheer for your team winners. Cheer for your winners. Cheer for your winners. Cheer for your winners. Guys, I don't hear anything. Cheer for your winners. Yes. So let's cheer for her. Guys, I don't hear your team member name, so shout them out louder. Cheer for your team members.
Krishna is
here. Okay, Krishna and Sandhya is here. Krishna?
Yes, Sandhya.
Krishna, we have Sandhya here. Guys, shout for Krishna, shout for Sandhya. Come on. Louder, cheer for team members, louder.
Krishna,
I should hear it.
Krishna!
Thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed the session. Till we meet again.